Good morning!
Good morning.
I like how Wayne took my chapter before I put it. Okay. He starts off Hebrews chapter 10, I was like, oh no. You can hear it twice. It's good for us to hear repetition.
Amen.
So I'm glad that none of y'all tried to drink this, and I hope none of you tried to figure out what it was by drinking it. Separate it slightly. I'm going to shake it up so it doesn't look as weird. So in the New Testament, we have this huge clash. We have the disciples of John. Then we have the disciples of the Pharisees. The disciples of the Sadducees. And then the disciples of Jesus. And if you notice, the disciples of Jesus are always being accused of some new sin. Whether it's, oh, they're not observing the Sabbath the way they want, that they wanted them to. Or they're not fasting. And before we get to this, I want you to understand that the Essenes, the disciples of John, and the disciples of the Pharisees are going to be fasting at one time of year. There is one time in the year where everybody is supposed to fast. And so when they ask, you know, why are your disciples not fasting? It's not, well, you know, it's a Tuesday, we should all be fasting. It was Yom Kippur. It was the Day of Atonement. The one day every year where blood was poured out. The one day every year where they take the goat, they take him outside the city and banish him. They take the other goat and they slit his throat and drain him off the blood and put it on the basin and sprinkle on the four parts of the altar. This is blood. Just so you know. That's why I'm glad none of y'all drank it, because I would be sick right now. If I came up here and this was half drink, I would be sick, just thinking of the thoughts. But the idea that once every year, somebody has to go in and sacrifice new every single year. And when Jesus speaks of this, you can just imagine the confusion. Think about it. We have a Christ who is sacrificed once. There's no reminder every year. There's this fast that comes on us in September, and we go, we don't need that. Christianity has this thing where, you know, the Jews have this fast for 24 hours. We have a meal every week. I mean, if you're going to go for a religion based just on the food, we win. Because Jesus replaced a fast with a meal. The Lord's Supper replaces this day in which it's a reminder. And that's how Hebrew calls it. It's this reminder of sin. This reminder of sin, and it's not one of those as you're set free. But hey, let me remind you, you're sinful again, go fast some more. Today we are in Mark chapter 2, starting in verse 13. And I want you to notice where he is. He sets the scene right here. I want you to realize where he is. I want you to realize that Galilee is, you know, the place of markets, the place of tax collectors, the place of fishermen. This is not Jerusalem. This is not a holy place. This is not where everybody else would be right now, especially the fact that they're celebrating the fast. They're going to Jerusalem. And he's not. He's going out to Galilee. He went out again beside the sea, and all the crowd were coming to him, and he was teaching them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he rose and followed him. And he reclined at table in his house. Many tax collectors and sinners were reclining with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. And the scribes of the Pharisees, when they saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, said to his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" And when Jesus heard it, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." I don't think we understand the weight of this. He is specifically saying, "You could be too religious for me." He is specifically saying to men who have devoted their lives to serving God, they've studied under a rabbi until the point they're allowed to serve as Pharisees. And he comes to them and he says this. He says, "I didn't come for you. I came not to call the righteous. Sinners. Today we're going to talk about sin, and I want you to view sin in a whole new light. Because in the Old Testament, we have tried to steal that concept. And it is, you're sinful, stay beat down. You're sinful. Be reminded every year how sinful you are. Stay in this state of remembering your sins. And in this, I want you to view this as this. Sin is what allows you to have a Savior. The reality of our sin allows us to have hope in Christ. And our reality of our sin then comes out, and we end, instead of with a fast today, we end with a feast. We end with a feast in which we celebrate the body and the blood, and we celebrate the removal of sin, because when we talk about sin, we say, thank you, Lord. Amen? Amen. The Pharisees continue with this concept, this questions about fasting. Verse 18. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and people came and said to him, why do John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. The days will come and when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast in that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins. And he says, there is coming a day in which they will fast, and we know of this day in which they fast. We know of this dark day that we call Friday. It's probably Thursday. Might be Wednesday. Truth is, we don't know what day it is. And we know of this day in which not only was there great sorrow for the apostles, but the sky. There's great sorrow in which the sun is blackened out, in which the dead walk out of their tombs, in which it is a day of utter darkness, in which the Son of God dies, in which the Son of God is crucified, and if there is a day of fasting, it was that. Because I want you to get a phrase in here, and it's, the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them. And he was. And in this there was fasting. And Christianity can end like that. With a day of fasting. But he continues with this slightly. He says something that just mind-blowing. Starts talking about wine and wineskins. Talks about needing a patch on clothes. And too often we take these things and we forget that there's this huge connection between two things. We forget that wine represents suffering. He says, can you drink the cup that I drink? Then you will. I don't think the disciples realize they just got cursed at that moment when he says, can you drink the cup? Yes! Okay, you will. And the cup that he drinks, he says, in the garden, he says, let this cup pass from me. But not my will, but yours be done. And every time we see wine, we need to be reminded of what it's supposed to represent. So often wine is blood. Wine is suffering and agony and blood. And he says that you can't put the new wine. This new sacrifice, this sacrifice of the Son of God cannot fit into this old wineskin you have. This day of fasting because you're sinful doesn't fit the blood of Christ. This day Everyone is called, no matter what sect you're from, to fast and remember how wicked you are, so that once again you can offer another lamb and do it again every year. Doesn't fit. Because the blood is that of Christ. And the sacrifice. Wayne read it this morning. The sacrifice is so much better. The blood is so much better. This morning we were talking about how if you went to the hospital and somebody said, I've got some, you know, lamb's blood, you're going to take the IV? No! You're going to die! Then you walk in and you say, okay, you know what, we have mostly human blood today, but it's mixed with a little bit of lamb blood. And we go, really? Because I'm going to die anyway. And that's what he's saying. He's saying this new wine won't fit. And if you try to make it fit, it just doesn't work. And in our sin, we no longer see this terrible suffering. We see new wine in fresh wineskins, and we say sin, and we say, thank you, Father, that it's yours, not mine. Thank you, God, that yes, I had sin, but you already took that. I don't need a reminder of my sinfulness. I need to know that I'm sinful and then turn that to this. Turn that new wine into this image of rejoicing, excitement. Because it's the only way it fits. This part is not in the PowerPoint, but the Pharisees tried one more attack on Jesus' disciples. One Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. And the Pharisees were saying to him, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? And he said to them, have you never read what David did? When he was in need and was hungry, he and those who were with him, how he entered the house of God in the time of after the high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat. And also gave it to those who were with him. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath. The Sabbath is this day of rest. We always think of it as one day a week. It's not always that. A Sabbath is any day that is dedicated to a day of rest and reflection on God. Sometimes there'd be multiple days of Sabbaths in a row. Sometimes it would fall once a week. Sometimes it would fall for 5 days in a week. And when his disciples, once again, are not observing this Sabbath in which there's one Sabbath a year where everyone must fast, and they're sitting there not only not fasting, they're plucking heads of grain and eating. And Jesus points to David and says, David did it. Don't you know that David ate the bread of presence? David ate holy bread, which he's not supposed to eat. Guess what happens? I mean, we know the story. So they go into the temple, David takes some bread, and boom, he's dead. Sorry. We have a big focus on death today. I don't know if it has to do with the blood or what's on my head, whatever. Does anybody remember that story? If you do, you're reading a really cool Bible. I just want to borrow something. It's not in mine. I mean, let's see. Jesus is quoting this. He's saying, yeah, look what David did. He's breaking the law. And then nothing. He eats the bread, and then he goes on his way and fights some more battles. That's the story. The Old Testament doesn't even make a point of it. It doesn't say, and he ate the bread, and tis. He shouldn't have done that. It just said, and then he goes on, and then he chases away from his son some more. Pause 5 seconds. He gets a meal and then he leaves. Okay. What? That's not what I was taught. I was always taught that if you ever broke the rules in the Old Testament, then boom, fire from heaven, you die. No, we have a God who is a little bit different than that. We have a God who actually decides between people's hearts. We have a God who has much more to say than what the Old Testament said on sin. We have a God who takes sin, and now we look at our sin and we just say, thank you. We look at our filth and nastiness and we're like, you know what? He told me this scale. He's like, okay, if you fit on this side, I don't want you. If you fit on this side, you're mine. And we look at our sin and we say, oh, have I got enough sin? And at the point we figure it out, at the point we look at ourselves and go, I've got enough sin, Jesus wants me. Because is that not what we started with? Did we not start with him saying, I do not call the righteous? I don't know. I thought Jesus said that. I thought it was the words of Christ, and he said, nope, too righteous. Whoa. And why did Paul have to say it? Why did he have to say there's none righteous? Because guess what? Some people just couldn't figure it out. Some people could not get to the point where they said, my sin is what requires a Savior. If I am perfect, I have no need of a Savior. And to look at the fact and say, you know what? They must really love God. It's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. It's just that story of this woman weeping and washing Jesus' feet with her tears. Jesus is talking about her love. And you're like, oh yeah, she probably loved Jesus because she was really into God now. She really loved Jesus because... And then Jesus tells us she was really sinful. And he tells a parable and he says, now if you're forgiven $100 and you're forgiven $1 million, which one are you going to love me more? He tells this parable and put it, you know, in modern terms, you know, I forgive you $100 and I forgive you $1 million. Which one do you think is going to love me more? And the parables of Jesus cut so dark and deep, and they're so dark and cutting. Because what's he saying? He's comparing our love to our sinfulness. And now we begin to see something brand new here. He says, new wine, fresh wineskins. It no longer fits. What fits is you and me being excited about God because we're sinful enough for Him. We're sinful enough to need a Savior. And we start looking at people and going, they're really sinful. They must either really love God or they haven't found him yet. We go down there, and I love where Jesus started. Did you notice it says, and he went to the temple in Jerusalem? No, he doesn't. It doesn't say that. He spends the first half of this book just wandering around. Where does he wander around? Galilee. Now you think about this, he's got this opportunity, he can spend this opportunity around Jerusalem and the temple and all the beauty and everything, and he says, and the next day he was around the sea again. Because it fits with what he said, he's there for sinners. He's there for all of us to re-see everything and say, you know what, my wineskin of religion doesn't fit anymore. My wineskin of religion that says, you know, religious people do this, this, and this. And Jesus is saying, wait, let me tell you about my apostles. He calls Levi. Who is Levi? Levi's the traitor. Ben-Hur. No, sorry. Whoa, wrong name. Oh. Ooh, sorry. Think about traitors. He is as much a traitor as anybody could ever be. Because not, they didn't have a nation, they had a religion wrapped around a god who was their king, and they were servants of a king, and you have this terrible, terrible Levi! He's working for the pagans! You know what he's doing? He's supporting those temples. He's the one that keeps these prostitutes in business! Because those prostitutes are supported by the state! He's the one that allows Rome to operate pagan temples! Y'all love Levi, don't y'all? And Jesus only gets one of the, actually gets two of those because he's really fun. And he gets another one, Matthew. Matthew, same thing, a traitor to his nation, supporting all that Rome represents, and Jesus calls him. Obviously the Pharisees are confused. We would be too. We would look at that and we'd say, that doesn't make any sense. And he says, new wineskins, get over it. He says, when you say it's religious and this is what religious people do, he's like, let me show you my religious people. Let me show you my sinners that I'm bringing in. Let me show you fishermen who are skipping Yom Kippur. Who are skipping. It's a holy day and they're out there drinking water because they're thirsty. Yeah, remember he called fishermen too? Ooh. None of these people are we going to look at and say they're great people. All of them we're going to look at, we're going to say they're sinners, and we're going to go back to the first thing Jesus says, and he says, I came for sinners, not righteous. And we're going to start looking at people, and we're going to say, they must really love God. They struggle with a lot. And those who have this perfect face, this perfect facade, we're going to look at and go, I guess you love Jesus a little bit, huh? You got a little love for Jesus, don't you? Because the most beautiful stories in the Bible are those women who come to Jesus. Two, first they're women. I mean, that was a strike against them. Second, they were a woman. And the Pharisees asked the same questions. Why don't your teachings look like our teachings? Because it doesn't fit. Today we offer an invitation. An invitation to view ourselves the way God wants us to view ourselves. Sinners who are offered a Savior. Sinners who he says, you are sinful enough. And today, we are sinful enough. Paul says that there is none righteous, no, not one. And we are sinful enough, and that is the only thing required of us to start our relationship with him is to believe in him, but to believe that we're sinful. To know that we are sinful in need of repentance so that we can confess him as Lord. He can wash us in the water. He can cleanse us and make us whole, fill us with his Holy Spirit, and use sinners like us. Today, that's the invitation for many of us. And then there's the invitation, if you need prayers, just to know that he gave us a body to pray for one another. And then if there's any you wish to submit to the eldership here, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.